So let's turn to chapter 1. Now skip this in the interest of time. I'm calling it the Eastern Mind. The Eastern Mind. Anyone here educated in the Orient or in Africa? Everyone here, okay? What, the whole education from like first grade through university or? Okay, so your experience with Eastern. Anyone else? What's your first name?
Enoch.
Enoch. Oh, I like that name. Enoch will understand this more experientially than the rest of us will, because I was educated in the West also. Let's talk about the Eastern mind. What's the best way to understand the Bible? I like this. Why don't we ask this guy? I think that would be a great idea. You know why? Because that guy was there when the Bible was written. He was carved on stone already then, but that guy was there. He saw the Bible as it unfolded in his culture. What is his culture? His culture is what we call East or Eastern. Our culture is what we call West or Western or Greek. Anything European or influenced by European, Canada, United States, Central and South America, anything influenced by Europe is Western. It's in the tradition of the Greeks. Anything from Africa, Asia, India, and even the Native American civilizations, North and South, are Eastern thinkers. Let me show you the difference. And for you philosophy majors, you're going to say this is hopelessly oversimplified. I agree 100%. But I need to do this in 5 minutes. A Westerner, a Western mind, the Greek tradition, thinks abstractly. That is, we abstract data out of a real life situation, and we study it. We break it into its pieces. We try and understand every piece. We put it back together. And each bit of information, we want to be able to put in a proposition that states the truth about this, that, or the other thing. We love definition. We love proposition. I like to start my high school or college or seminary classes with this question. I'm in a religious setting, okay? High school and college and seminary. So I can ask this in a genuinely religious sense. Who or what is God? Now, I get all kinds of wonderful answers. I'd love to do that here this morning, but again, I will try and save my time for something that I think is more crucial to where you are. The answers I get are good. God is powerful. God is love. God is everywhere. Someone will say, God is omniscient. God is holy. Then I say, close your eyes. Those of you that haven't already, go ahead. Okay, close your eyes. Now, close your eyes. I'm going to say those words, and you see what comes into your mind. God is holy. God is righteous. God is powerful. God is everywhere. God is omniscient. Open your eyes. What did you see? Some kid will say Grand Canyon, and we'll have to explore that. I explained Grand Canyon was originally, the origin of the Grand Canyon was a Dutch guy lost a nickel in a gopher hole, and he was looking for, never mind. The Grand Canyon, somebody will say. Now, I don't know where that comes from, but it tends to come up. But those words are Western. That is, you don't see holy. You don't see omniscient. You don't feel it. It operates rationally on the mind. Now, there's nothing wrong with it. Those are awesome words. God is holy and righteous and everywhere. But a Westerner wants to take information and present it in abstract idea or abstract definition or proposition so that we can examine it and decide if it's true. That's you, to some degree or another. Some of you are very comfortable with this. All you math and business majors and you logic people, this is right down your alley. Some of you artists move a little bit in another direction. But an Easterner is totally different when it comes to looking at the same truth. Now, I'm going to call it Hebrew because Hebrew is East, but it's much bigger than that. Hebrew thinkers want truth in concrete picture or story language. They don't want to abstract out of real life situation. They want to enter into life situation. Now, when I take students to Israel, and we do our Israel seminar, I will try and get into a Jewish school because I want to show them how different their thinking is. And I will say in the Jewish school, who is God? I mean, in the Eastern Jewish school, Orthodox Jewish school, at least no one would raise their hand. They just shout it out. That's how you do in the East. Immediately, who is God? Oh, the Lord is my shepherd. God is a rock. God is living water. God is shade. God is bread. God is like a nursing mother. God is father. God is eagle's wings. Now, if you close your eyes, every single one of those speaks to you where? Here first, and then here. Because it's not precise to say God is my shepherd. What does that mean? That's what it means to you. He looks after us. What else does it mean? He gathers us. What else does it mean?
He takes care of us.
There's a thousand. Very good. Akiva said every text has 70 faces. There's 70 things every text means. Why? Because it's a picture that you interpret. Let me tell you something. I can make a good case. Ask me later, like at a break or some other time. I can make a good case that the light of the world, Jesus, was conceived on the Feast of Lights. That the one who will lead us to the Promised Land was born on Sukkot, the Feast of the Promised Land. The bread of the world was born in a town called Bethlehem. What does Beth mean? No, close. You got the wrong half. Beth. In Hebrew, Beth is house or place. Lechem, or Lechem, is bread. House of bread. What's a house of bread? So the bread of the world was born in a bakery. And people, you chuckle as a Westerner. Oh, that's cute. That's exactly how God thinks when it came to presenting his truth. It's no accident that the bread of the world is born in a bakery. He says, see the picture? Of course the bread of the world has to be born in a bakery. He's the bread of the world. And we think, oh, that's so cute. Cute? That's one of the most profound revelations of the nature of God you'll ever hear. That picture matters deeply to God. And he's put in a manger, which everybody fills with this terrible-looking golden straw. I hate it. Because a manger is for water. Maybe they drained it out first. Maybe it was still wet. And the living water, the bread born in the bakery, the living water, gets placed in a water trough where the sheep come to drink the living water. Do you see the picture? Now, the Westerner hopes to God. I'm going to come across very anti-Western. I'm not. The Westerner hopes and prays to reach people's hearts by changing their minds. How much of your religious background has been an attempt to teach you what to think? The Easterner tries to reach your mind by touching your heart. Now, why is this important? Listen to me. Sorry. I'm too Jewish. You know why Dutch people have round shoulders and flat heads? Because if you ask Dutch people, I'm Dutch. If you ask Dutch people stuff, they'll go, they ask them a question, they'll go, I don't know. And when you tell them, they go, man, I should have known that. The reason this is important is that the Bible was written to Easterners by Easterners. The whole book. Even those sections we would say tend to be more Western, like the book of Hebrews, if you look carefully, are very Eastern. And so when you read the book, you are attempting to take an Eastern truth and to describe it in an abstract way, which isn't wrong, but you've taken a step away from the original. Now, the foundation I need to build for you insists that there is value, not the only way, there is value in reading the Bible in its cultural setting, which is, first of all, Eastern. Let me unpackage that just a little bit more, and I'm going to do the Jewish thing and quit in the middle, but I need to give you some examples. So what? In the East, numbers are, first of all, symbols. And then quantity. To the West, numbers, first of all, are quantity. And maybe we will look for symbolism in them. One of my favorite biblical stories, David and Goliath. Goliath is described. He is 6 cubits tall. Now, you're a Westerner, so the question that runs through your mind is, what's a cubit? How tall is he? 6 cubits. What is that? About 9'6", depending on who the king is. The cubit changed. He wore armor that weighed 6,000 shekels. What's a shekel? About 140 pounds total. He had a spear point that weighed 60 talents. What's a talent? You want to know the Easterner would say, they wouldn't say this, but I'll show you the logic they go through. Why would God tell us about his armor and his height and his spear point and not about his sword and his shield and his greaves and his javelin? Why aren't those? Because there's something about those three numbers. So if Goliath had been an athlete on a team, what was his number?